Hey, thanks for checking out our innovation podcast. Hopefully this gives you some encouragement for the rest of your week.
All right, so hey, if you got a Bible with you this morning, we're going to be in Luke 17. And we are in the second part of a series that we kicked off last week called Moodswingers. And here's what I love about this series, is this series is all about how we can swing our moods before they swing us. In other words, here's what I mean. When I look back at the bad decisions I've made in my life, when I look back and I've said things I shouldn't have said, or I've done things I shouldn't have done, normally if I trace that back, what I discover is there's some attitude or mood that I have that is influencing those decisions, right? We don't just act for no reason. We act based on the fact that we have an attitude or a mood deep down inside of us. And so last week we kicked off this series talking about the mood or attitude of confidence. And we talked about how a lack of confidence is actually a spiritual problem, because the way we're supposed to be confident is that we're not supposed to be confident in ourselves, but we're meant to be cultivating God confidence. And so we looked at 1 Corinthians 10:12, where Paul writes and he says, forget self-confidence, right? It's useless. Cultivate God confidence. Next week, we're going to talk about another mood that I'm not going to tell you about yet, because I want you to be just excited for next week. But this week, we're talking about the mood or the attitude of gratitude. And really the reason we're talking about it is this: I think that God has given us way more than we give him credit for, and that our lack of gratitude actually can be poisonous for us if we're not careful. But I think we're also living in a culture where gratitude is definitely not expressed as often as it should be. In fact, take a little test later today, get on social media, scroll through your timeline, and count how many times somebody says they're thankful for something, or they're just expressing thanks for something, versus how many times they're complaining about something, or whining about something, or being cynical about something. I am willing to bet you, if I was a gambling man, I'd even give you good odds that you're going to find more people being cynical and just not being happy with their life. But we, as followers of Christ, here's the challenge. We are meant to be the light of the world and the salt of the earth, and we cannot do that if we're complaining all the time, right? So I want to pray for us before we jump in this morning. And the reason we pray every single Sunday before we jump into the message is really simple, is we believe that what happens when we open the God's word, we open the Bible, that life transformation happens, that this is not simply like a classroom lecture where there's information being passed from the teacher to the student. There's more than that happening here. We believe that God is changing our lives every time we open his word, because what the word says is that it's living and active, that it's actually having an effect on our lives. And so just to prove that to you, just to celebrate, man, in the past 4 weeks, we've seen 8 people on our weekends decide to follow Jesus. That is incredible. And that doesn't happen because we're creative or because somebody says something smart or funny, because man, if we are going to do this thing based on my own wit and my own smarts, we're in trouble, right? It doesn't happen because we have good music, even though we do. It happens because the Holy Spirit is moving in people's lives, and we're being faithful to really study his word together. So I'd like to pray for us that God would help us to hear him and see him more clearly because of our time together, because that's what changes our lives, all right? Will you join me in prayer? Jesus, we thank you so much for how good you've been. God, for how much you love us, how gracious you've been to us. And really, God, we thank you for all the ways that you're taking care of us. God, we trust you this morning that you're going to help us to hear you and see you more clearly, that we're going to walk out of here better than we walked in here. God, we're going to walk out of here closer to you and stronger than before. God, we trust you that you're changing our lives from the inside out. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Do you guys know anybody that gets really, like, moody? Like, they just get an attitude and they totally shut down, right? If you would be honest enough to say you're a moody person, would you just raise your hand? If you would be honest enough to say you're married to a moody person, don't raise your hand. That's a trap. Don't do it. My wife is definitely married to a moody person, okay? I tend to kind of go from one extreme to the other. I'm not as consistent as I wish I was. And I got that proven to me a few weeks ago. We were having some car trouble with our Explorer. That's the car that we use to pull the trailer back and forth every single week. All of a sudden, decided it did not want to be in my car anymore, dropped off. And so we have this car where if we wanted to fix it, it would cost us about $2,000. But my car has like 200,000 miles on it. So we were like, no, we're not doing that. So I get the call from the transmission guy. That's what he says. And I'm like, okay, we can deal with that, right? It was kind of upsetting, but I handled it better than I thought I was going to. So I call my wife and I give her the news and I say, hey, here's what happened. Here's what the guy said. No big deal. We'll be able to deal with it. It's going to be fine. And no sooner than I hung up the phone with her, I'm driving our other car. The other car we have is a 97 Chevy Malibu. My car is older than some people in here, but 97 Chevy Malibu. And all of a sudden, as I turn onto the highway, I get off the phone with my wife, I hit the end call button, whatever that is. And no joke, I hear something snap inside the hood, and I can hear it whipping around inside there, hitting the metal. Car starts overheating, smoke's pouring out everywhere. I pull over in a gas station, I can see it. I didn't know what it was at the time, but it was the tensioner in the car had snapped and it had wrapped around one of the belts and it had messed that belt up and broke the belt. The car was just, at that point in time, shot. And so I do the only thing I can do. I call State Farm, I got the tow coming, and I waited for that tow for not one, not two, but 3 hours sitting in the parking lot of a gas station. And can I tell you, because I'm moody, for those 3 hours, I kind of covered everything, right? You go from being completely ticked off and like sitting there, if I can just be completely honest with you, shaking the steering wheel because you're so angry, yelling at a car that can't hear you. And then eventually what happened, I'll be honest with you, what happened is the longer I was in there, my attitude started to change. And I started praying a little bit. It wasn't like one of those prayers where you get down on your knees and you're like calling out to heaven. It was just kind of quiet prayer, just kind of thinking and processing things. And what happened is about 2.5 hours in, I started thinking, okay, well, I don't want to be too ticked off when the tow guy gets here because I'm going to have to ride with him to the shop because my other car is at the shop. So I got to pick up my other car from the shop when I get this other one dropped off because apparently we can't have two cars that run at the same time. So I start thinking through that, and I start thinking through the fact that, man, I know plenty of people who don't have a single vehicle, and yet I have two. And even if both of them are in the shop, I have two cars in the shop. And then I started thinking, well, we got the money to fix this. That shouldn't be a big deal. So that's pretty good. And I started thinking, even with all this stuff, like, life isn't as bad as it feels right now. And see, here's what happens. When life gets overwhelming, and if you're a moody person like me, your bad attitude can be consuming. And your attitude can blind you to the truth. Your attitude can blind you to reality. And so here's what I learned in my car and what I want to share with you and what's on your note sheet is this, is that gratitude begins where my bad attitude ends. Gratitude begins where my bad attitude ends. In other words, man, I have a bad attitude because I'm moody, but every single one of us have bad attitudes. Your bad attitude might not make you blow up, but your bad attitude might make you very apathetic. Might just make you kind of sit around, ho-hum, and not try anything. Maybe your bad attitude doesn't make you blow up, but it makes you just super negative all the time. Like you're just down on everything. You can't think positively for even a minute because that's just your attitude in the moment. Maybe you just feel like everything's a lost cause. That's your bad attitude. Maybe you don't ever give people second chances because you tried it before and they just messed up. So you can't do it again. You can't trust them. Right? The truth is we all have bad attitudes, but if we're going to be people who express gratitude or really any positive emotion, we have to understand this, that only happens when our bad attitude ends. And so for us to experience gratitude, we have to understand that we have to push through some of our bad attitudes, some of those things that want to war against us and keep us from focusing on what's true. Because the reality for us is this, is that God has given you so much to be thankful for. We might not express it very often, but the very fact that you got up this morning and you were able to come to church, that's something to be grateful for. The very fact that you have a breath to breathe right now, like you've been sitting here listening to me for a couple minutes now, and nobody thought, okay, how do I breathe this next breath? That's pretty good, right? You've got something to be thankful for. Some of you have incredible families. That's awesome. Some of you have okay families. That's better than other people, right? Some of you have jobs that you can tolerate. That's awesome. Not everybody has that. We all have something we can be thankful for, but the reality is our culture has taught us to not be grateful. Our culture has taught us, just by watching other people, hearing other people, living life with other people, that it's so much easier to be cynical than it is to be thankful. But lucky for us, this is not a new problem. In fact, even in the scriptures, Jesus experienced people who had a huge lack of gratefulness. In fact, in Luke 17, here's what we see starting here in verse 11. It's on your note sheet if you want to follow along on there or up on the screen. But Luke 17, starting in verse 11, this is all about Jesus. And Luke, here's what I love about Luke. If you've never read the Gospel of Luke, Luke is not seeing anything that he's writing about firsthand. Luke is a doctor. He's been commissioned by a wealthy man to go out and figure out who this Jesus guy is. He wants to learn more about him. So Luke is going to people who were eyewitnesses to these accounts, and he's investigating. So he's comparing and contrasting stories. He's learning about all these different things so he can share it with the guy who sent him out to teach him. And so as he's hearing these stories, he's sharing what he thinks are incredibly important. And this is one of those important stories. Verse 11 says, on the way to Jerusalem, he, being Jesus, was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. So if you're on your way to Jerusalem, if you can kind of, I know a lot of Bibles don't have maps anymore, but I like when Bibles have maps because then you can see everything. If you can visualize it, you've got Samaria, Galilee up north, Samaria just south, and Jerusalem is way further south. So he's still a ways away, but he's in between those two cities north of Jerusalem. And it says in verse 12, as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance. Now, here's why they're standing at a distance. If you're not familiar with leprosy, leprosy is a disease that would slowly eat away at you. And it was very visible to many people that you had leprosy. And so lepers in Jesus's day, they didn't have any way to really treat them. So what they did is they ostracized them. They sent them away. They made sure that these people had no social interaction with healthy people, no physical interaction with healthy people. And so if you can imagine, if you're a person who has leprosy through no fault of your own, you're living a life that is very different than everybody else's life. You're living a life that is distant from other people. And so these 10 lepers are standing at a distance because they don't dare get close, because what they're supposed to do is anytime they're walking through and they're around people who do not have leprosy, they would literally have to call out every single step, unclean, unclean. They would have to declare to people their problem all the time. And so Jesus passes by, they're standing at a distance, and it says in verse 13 that they lifted up their voices saying, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Now, here's why that's so important, is they would have heard about Jesus probably, right? If you got a guy who's feeding 5,000 men with just two fish and a few loaves of bread, you're hearing that story, right? They're hearing about Jesus. They're hearing all about him. And so they've heard the stories, and now they're saying, okay, well, maybe this is where something can be different for us. So they start calling out, have mercy on us. In other words, they're saying, help us. They're pointing their attention to Jesus. In verse 14, Jesus says this. It says he saw them and he said, go and show yourselves to the priests. Now, a lot of times when Jesus heals people, he does things that seem weird, right? Like, so in other words, there's this guy in John chapter 9 who's blind. And Jesus decides he's going to pick up dirt, spit in it, make it into mud, put it on the guy's eyes. And as he washes his eyes off, he's healed. There's other accounts where Jesus heals somebody simply by touching them, or sometimes they touch Jesus and they're healed just because Jesus is that cool. But in this instance, Jesus does something different. He has no physical interaction with these 10 men. All he says is, go and show yourselves to the priests. But notice what happens. The second they start walking to where they're supposed to go, it says, and as they went, they were cleansed. As they went, they were cleansed. In other words, as they were doing what Jesus told them to do, their life was changed. As they went to do what Jesus told them to do, their life was changing. Can I tell you, 2,000 years later, it's not any different. If you are feeling stuck in your life, if you're feeling like something isn't going the way that you hoped it would go, whatever that is for you, can I tell you, the way that gets better is not by doing things your way, but by doing things the way that Jesus would have you do them. Doesn't mean it's going to be comfortable. Doesn't mean it's always going to make sense. Doesn't mean you're even going to want to. But they, as they went, were cleansed. And for us, as we do what Jesus tells us to do, that's when our life is changed. We don't get to do it our own way. We have to follow Jesus' way. So as they went, they're cleansed. Now, if you're a person who's had leprosy and all of a sudden you get better, don't you think you're noticing that, right? There's 10 men, but only one of them has like this aha moment. It says in verse 15, one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now, he was a Samaritan. Now, here's what makes that so important is a Samaritan in Jesus' day, they did not get along with Jewish people. And to say they didn't get along is actually a huge understatement. Culturally, these two groups hated each other. Didn't want to be around each other, wouldn't associate with each other. You did not, if you were a Jewish man, marry a Samaritan woman. If you were a Samaritan girl, you didn't bat your eyes at a Jewish boy. You stayed away from each other, right? Because culturally, you were at odds. So Jesus, a Jewish man, heals 10 people, but the one that turns around is a Samaritan. Notice Jesus' response to this one man. Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" See, Jesus asked the question, weren't 10 healed? Now, he doesn't ask that question because he doesn't know. Jesus knows everything, right? But he says, were not 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Only one person turns around. So Jesus looks at him and he says this. He says, rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well. Now, if I can be honest, here's what I love about this verse, but it also kind of hurts, is I feel like these verses in Luke 17, for us culturally, are almost like a mirror. In other words, when we see this, it looks a lot like the day and age we find ourselves in. And the funny thing about a mirror is this, is a mirror requires action from you, right? Here's how I know that. When you woke up this morning and you looked in the mirror, I don't think any of us went, good enough, right? You looked in the mirror, you changed something with your hair, if you have hair to change. Not making fun of anybody specific. You brushed your teeth. You maybe shaved a little bit, right? You checked again. You probably looked in the mirror multiple times. And at some point, even if you still didn't like what you saw, you went, okay, now after looking in the mirror multiple times, this is finally okay. It's acceptable, right? A mirror requires a response from us. And really, these verses are like a mirror for our culture. You have 10 people that are healed, 10 people that God is gracious to, and yet only one gives him thanks for it. I think it's fair to say we're in a culture that does not recognize everything that God has done for it and all the ways that God has taken care of us. And there are a few people that are deciding, hey, we're going to turn around and give thanks to God for it, but many people haven't and maybe never, ever will. And so here's my challenge for you today. Really what I want to talk about just for the next couple minutes is this, is how can we be the one? How can we be the one who's actually grateful? How can we be like the one who turned around and decided, okay, I'm not just going to let God do great things for me and never thank him for it, but I'm going to live a life that has an attitude of gratitude. I'm going to be filled with thanks towards God. I'm going to allow that to be cultivated inside of me. Because once again, here's why this is so important, is if you do not cultivate this attitude of gratitude, your heart will become cold. Your heart will get hardened towards other people. And that attitude, your heart is going to affect every relationship you have. It's going to affect your success at work. It's going to affect everything about you. But if you're a person of gratitude, here's the great thing. Man, you're creating a foundation for God to do even more than he's done before. And so how do we cultivate this attitude of gratitude? I've got 3 thoughts for you I want to share with you real quick. And the first thought is this on your note sheet is thank God for what you have. Thank God for what you have. It is so easy for us to take for granted what we already have, right? Because we are obsessed not with what we have, but with what's next and what's better, right? So in other words, if you buy a new phone, you're hoping they don't come out with a newer version of it in the next couple months. Why? Because you want the newest and the best. We are always thinking about what's next, what's better, because automatically what we do is we take what we have and we compare it to everyone else, right? We compare our cars, we compare our looks, we compare our styles, which by the way, on point today, right? Even though my wife disagrees. She hates that. She hates when I say she doesn't like it. But it's true. I don't want to lie in church. She doesn't like it. Right? We compare every single thing in our lives because we have learned that if we're going to be happy, we have to have something that's better than the next person and something that's more than the next person, because if they have it better, then we must be missing something. And so we're constantly consumed with more and what's better, and we fall into a trap to constantly worry about what's next. But here's the thing about a relationship with God, is that if we put God first, we don't have to worry about what's next. If we put God first, we don't have to worry about what's next. We don't have to think about the next thing because God is always going to take care of us. God's going to take care of all of our needs, maybe not all of our wants, but he's definitely going to take care of all of our needs. In fact, in Matthew 6, verse 33 and 34, he's speaking to people. He's preaching on a mountainside, and here's what he says. He says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness." In other words, his way of doing things. "And all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow." In other words, don't worry about tomorrow. "For tomorrow will be anxious for itself." Tomorrow has enough worries for itself. In other words, Jesus is saying, if you'll seek God first, you don't have to worry about your needs being taken care of. He's going to take care of them. We need to learn how to thank God for what we have. One of my favorite people in the entire Bible is David in the Old Testament. David, if you're familiar with him, or even if you're not, he's the one who killed the giant named Goliath. And David, here's what I'll tell you. That was one of his first big battles, but he would have a lot of battles after that. In fact, most of what happens in David's life happens years and decades after him fighting Goliath. He would go through a lot of turmoil and have a lot of problems. But after defeating Goliath, he writes a psalm, and it's there on your note sheet, Psalm 9. And here's how he starts it out. He says, "I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds." He says, in this moment, yes, I just had a victory, but we all know, no matter how great of a victory you have now, there's stuff that's still coming up. He says, in this moment, I will give thanks to God with my whole heart. I will thank him with everything that I have for what I have right now. If you catch yourself feeling a lack of gratitude, just think about for a moment what other people don't have. In fact, one of the most humbling things you can do is just drive down towards Route 8 and look at people who are stuck begging for money every day, right? And you think, you've got it bad. There is always somebody who has it worse. There's always going to be somebody who has it better in your eyes, but there's always somebody who has it worse. We need to learn how to thank God for what we already have. The second thing is this, and this is the most challenging. I promise you, this is going to hurt you a little bit. Celebrate what God has done for others. Celebrate what God has done for others. That is really hard to do when you feel like you're missing out on something. I remember after my wife and I had a miscarriage, it got really hard to get on social media for a season, right? Because when you're our age, I'm 31 now, but at the time we were in our late 20s, you have friends who, right after we have a miscarriage, you're seeing pregnancy announcement after pregnancy announcement after pregnancy announcement. And here's what I'll tell you. I caught myself getting angry, and I caught myself getting bitter. Every time I would see that, I would wonder, well, God, you're doing that for them. Why won't you do that for us? And I would start thinking things too, like this is just the way your heart works. I would start thinking, well, I can almost guarantee you I've sacrificed more for God than they have, and it's working out for them. Why isn't it working out for me? And I remember my wife and I, we had like a come to Jesus moment where we just had to get our hearts right and had to apologize to God for some things. And we made the decision that we were going to not just celebrate, but like overly celebrate people and their accomplishments more than we ever had before. And we decided that we were going to give more towards people when they had a baby, when they were getting ready to have a baby. We were going to give more financially, more verbal praise, more Facebook messages, more prayers to them. We were just going to celebrate what God had done for others, because at the end of the day, even though we didn't always feel like it, that is the best way for us to protect our hearts in that moment. To say, man, I don't have what you have. Man, I'm so pumped for you, and I'm so excited for you. When you make the decision to celebrate what God's doing for others, it changes your heart. If you grew up in church, you've heard this verse before, but it's Proverbs 4:23. It says, keep your heart. Some most translations say, guard your heart with all vigilance, for from it flow the springs of life. Guard your heart. Keep your heart with all vigilance. We have to protect our hearts. And honestly, guys, one of the ways we protect our hearts is celebrating what God has done for others, even when you don't feel like it. Here's why that's hard, though. Because we are hardwired to compare ourselves to other people. we are hardwired to look at people who are roughly the same age, and we'll compare bank accounts, we'll compare relationship statuses, we'll compare the kind of vehicle they drive, the kind of house they live in, the way their kids behave and ours don't behave. We're hardwired to compare everything, but comparison, once again, is a tricky trap. And Teddy Roosevelt said this. He said, comparison is the thief of joy. Comparison is the thief of joy. It's a guy who lived decades ago, but understood, even in his day and his culture, if you want to lose all your joy in life, begin to compare yourself to other people. Here's what I believe. I believe that celebrating others is a spiritual exercise. It's a spiritual exercise. Because once again, it's changing our hearts, this heart that God's giving us. It's allowing us, when we celebrate other people, to be present with other people when everything inside of you wants to retreat. It is so easy when you feel left out or less than to run away. But here's why that's so spiritual. It's because your enemy, the devil, does not want you to interact with other people. He wants you to be isolated. He wants you to be by yourself. And when we allow ourselves to get bitter and our hearts to get hardened, we isolate. But the goal should be, man, I want to be present with people. In fact, a verse that my wife brought back to my memory this week that we had talked about years ago was Romans 12:15. Paul says this. He says, rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. In other words, be present. Celebrate with people who are celebrating. Have fun with those who are having fun. Give thanks with those who are giving thanks. But man, be there with people whose hearts are broken. Weep with the people who are weeping. Be present. When you feel like you need to retreat, that is absolutely the time you need to engage. In fact, they'll tell you, this might be a little weird, but I was a youth pastor. I used to study these things a lot. They'll say that the biggest mistakes that dads make in the lives of their daughter is when their daughter is old enough to develop and starts having their period, guys tend to retreat. And that is the moment when they need their dads the most. Spiritually, here's what happens, guys and girls. When you feel like you should be retreating, that is absolutely the time you need biblical community more than ever. That's when you need to be at church. You need to be in a small group. You need to be texting people, talking to people, praying with people, praying for people, inviting people to pray for you. That's when you need it. We need to celebrate what God has done for others, because honestly, it's affecting us more than we realize. It's developing you one way or the other. Third and final thing is this. We don't just need to thank God for what we have, and we don't just need to celebrate what God has done for others, but we need to praise God for what he will do. Praise God for what he will do. In other words, you're going to begin thanking him and worshiping him for things that he has not done yet. And if I'm sitting in your seat, here's what I'll tell you. The second I wrote this down the other day, the thought that came to my mind was, well, isn't that just faking it? You ever feel that way? Somebody like me tells you, hey, you need to thank God for what he hasn't done yet. And you're thinking, why would I do that? I'd just be lying. Well, that's not what you're doing. You're not faking it. I want to give you a new word. It's super cheesy, but it's a new word. You're faithing it. All right? In other words, you're injecting faith when you don't want to and you don't feel like you should. You're injecting faith into the scenario to say, okay, God, things aren't working out the way I hoped right now, but it won't always be this way. I'm not happy with my relationship status now, but it's not always going to be like this. I'm not happy with where our family is now, but we're not always going to be in this spot. I'm not happy with this, but it's going to change. You're just thanking God ahead of time to say, okay, right now, I can't see it because I'm in the midst of a season that sucks, but I'm ready for the change, and God, I believe you're going to change it. Man, you're thanking God, praising God for what he will do, even though he hasn't done it yet. And here's what I'll tell you. That is what separates people who have found hope and live in hope in Christ and those who don't. That is what separates true worshipers of God and people who just want to stare. That is the difference maker between living a life that is pursuing God and a life that is just sitting back and waiting. Man, God is worthy to be worshipped even when it doesn't seem like things are working out, because here's what I'll tell you. I believe every single day with Jesus, things are going to get better. I believe that your best truly is yet to come and that God wants to do some incredible things in your life. And he doesn't need you to fake it, but we definitely do need faith, our confidence in God to say, okay, God, you can do anything and you will do anything. Because once again, like we prayed earlier today, we have a choice to make. When life happens, we can worry about life, or we can worship the one who holds our lives in his hands. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 28 says this. It says, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Here's what I love about that. Because in other words, we've received something. When you start a relationship with Jesus Christ, you're receiving something that isn't going to run away, isn't going to get beaten down, isn't going to change. It's not going to get shaken. When life gets the toughest, it's still a firm foundation for you. Let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And then, thus, let us offer to God acceptable worship. And notice what that worship is. It's with reverence and awe, with respect for him, but also wonder. I got really challenged this week by my wife. She could not pick up our son for like a week because she had surgery. And most of our life, if I can be honest right now, consists of us picking him up and putting him back down. That's what he wants to do all day. So if he's awake, we are transferring him from one spot to the other all day. So my wife can't pick him up, and it's incredibly hard because all of a sudden now she's just sitting there going, what do I do with my time? And so she had a stretch of 3 days where she read a book a day. 3 days, like just started crushing it. And one of those books was a book that I can't recommend more highly to you. It's called Chase the Lion by Mark Batterson. It's all about chasing God's dream for your life. And I was reading the other day between that book and another book of his that I'm reading. And he talks about how when we stop dreaming of what God can do in our life, that's the day we stop really living. I think for us, man, we lose our awe, our wonder of God really quickly. It's easy for us just to see life and how things aren't working out and get upset and to kind of shut down. But man, we need to recapture the wonder of God. I remember when I first became a Christian, I had this confidence that God truly could do anything. And it's easy the longer you're in this thing, and it's easy the longer you just live life and things happen, it's easy to lose that wonder that tells you, man, that God can do anything. He said, let us be grateful for this kingdom that cannot be shaken and worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. God wants to take over your life. He wants to take the worry that you have and replace it with something else. He wants to take those times where you feel ungrateful, and he wants you to feel grateful. He wants to shape your heart and change your life from the inside out. He wants to consume your life. He doesn't just want to be a tiny part of it. He wants to be all of it. And so now for us, it's the choice. We get to choose, what role does God really play in our lives? How much of my life am I really going to give to him? Is he worth part of it? Or am I going to let him be what he says he is, that consuming fire that's all of my life, that changes the way I see things?